dying.
Stand by. Programming is about to begin. I just have to fix one last thing and figure out where the music is coming from. Ah, go away. All of you go. Okay, let's try it now. Yeah. All right, here we go.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is every Friday. Marcy Wheeler of EmptyWheel.net is my guest. We talk about what happened in the preceding week. Today, I'm giving you fair warning that we will again run overtime today. So if you're listening to one of the live audio streams on Progressive Voices or one of the other stations that carry us, come on over to NicoleSandler.com or go to our YouTube channel. Because I'm going to, Marcy, the segment with Marcy will run a couple of minutes long, and then I'm going to stay on to pay tribute to a dear friend, a great musician, who unfortunately we lost yesterday. So stick around. We'll segue into the weekend with music and memories and hopefully a good feeling. And we start that way as well with Marcy Wheeler. Take it away, videotape.
Well, it is a Friday, and I always look forward to Fridays for the obvious reasons. But the newest obvious reason is Marcy Wheeler is here. And this time, we have a lot of breaking news from today.
We always have a lot of breaking news, Nicole. Like every Friday, it's like, oh, okay. But this time the news actually broke before we got on the podcast.
Exactly, because I was convinced that Judge McAfee was going to issue his ruling about whether or not Fulton County, Georgia DA Fani Willis was going to be disqualified. Like and release it right after we finished taping. But no, he did it first thing this morning. So thankfully, and it was the best news we could hope for, I guess.
Well, I mean, as I said last Friday, he could have booted her depending on the standard he applied. He applied the legally correct standard, which is it had to be an actual conflict, not an appearance of conflict. But said, because of the appearance of conflict, we want people to have faith in this prosecution. And so either you, Fani, and your team get off, or Nathan Wade get off. So I assume Nathan Wade is going to resign.
Yeah.
I don't think he has yet. But you know, it is what I said last week, is that they're you know, again, they hadn't proven their case, but they had raised enough questions about it that... And it is what it is. I think Wade was a pretty good attorney. I think there are other people on Fani Willis' team who are quite strong, some who are not as strong. But we move forward to fight another day.
Yeah, so that's good news. I was a little worried because earlier in the week, the same judge dismissed six of the charges. Three against Trump, but six of the total charges in Georgia. He said that there was an abundance of evidence, but more specificity was needed for these charges, all of them having to do with the so-called perfect phone call that Trump made to them.
One of them having to do with the perfect phone call, okay. And other instances of solicitation like that, asking people to break the law. And so, as I understand it, Willis could go back and re-indict it, but people who know what they're doing suggest she really would be better off not doing it because it would set it back and open herself up the same legal challenges we've already been through. And so, but it doesn't really matter. The RICO charge remains. But it is a very good instance, right? It does. The perfect phone call was one. So it's one charge against Trump, but also the main charge against Mark Meadows, or one of the main overt acts against Mark Meadows. It's very, people always say, how hard can it be to indict Donald Trump? He called up Brad Raffensperger and asked for 11,000 votes. Well, the answer is it's not as easy as you think. right? I think Judge McAfee is a very fair judge. Thanks I think that if this does go to trial, people should have reasonable confidence in it. Because, you know, he was appointed by Governor Kemp. He'll be on the ballot again in November. The trial will actually happen after November. I assume he'll win. I have a lot of confidence in this judge. I think I think the ruling was fair. I think he criticized Fani Willis for public comments. I think it's likely mm-hmm. Fani Willis is going to end up getting gagged. I think that's all appropriate. But the larger point is, yeah, it is not that easy to charge somebody, even if it looks like a crime happened in plain sight, because of the way the law works and because judges are going to go out there and defense attorneys are going to go out there. And so I think people should, you know, people are going to continue to go after Fani Willis. Georgian Republicans are going to go after her. Jim Jordan's going to continue to go after her. It's never going to be easy. And again, that is a lesson that if you want to prosecute Donald Trump, you know, you need to bring your A game every day, and you can't make it easy for him to discredit you, as I think the affair with Nate Wade did.
Was just uncalled for, unnecessary, stupid, if I could use that word. It was just stupid. And at a time when I think any prosecutions of him need to be flawless, because we are dealing with a former president, number one, and number two, somebody who is in a position and is working every day to try to undo our democracy. I mean, the stakes couldn't be higher.
Yeah, yeah. And now we can segue to the Alvin Bragg case.
Yes.
Which is,
30-day postponement of the New York fraud trial. That's the hush money payment to Stormy Daniels, but so much more than that. So it's New York fraud trial. Was supposed to begin on March 25th. And yesterday, Alvin Bragg said he agreed to a 30-day postponement. Apparently, Trump's people wanted 90 days. But this stems from SDNY's delay in turning over some files. This is the DOJ,
Clear. Yeah. So if you look at Adam Klasfeld and other people who are covering that closely, there's another discovery letter just out before we got on, and I haven't read it yet, but the short version is that the last dump is, I think, going to be today. Today's dump, like the first dump of 70,000 pages, is not pertinent to this case. So there's 30,000 that may be pertinent to this case that SDNY didn't turn over right away. We'll see what it is. And we'll see how much surface area it gives Donald Trump. I suspect, given that the dump that comes today is not going to be related to the case, that if there is the judge hasn't decided what kind of delay there's going to be. There might not be a delay, but if there is a delay, it's likely just going to be the 30 days, especially because Trump permitted SDNY to delay its response to this. So,
Yeah, that's correct. I just pulled up Adam Klasfeld's at Klasfeld Reports Shitter account. And his latest post said it would appear that no more 11th hour productions from federal prosecutors could derail the trial calendar further. And in fact, one logistical hurdle has been cleared. And I guess that's the final production of 15,000 records today. Yeah, it makes me wonder, and it goes back to, you know, what you talked about last week, Marcy, about the, you know, the January 6th committee not turning over the transcripts to the Justice Department. It seems like the people that should be cooperating with one another aren't.
Well, I did a post where we don't know what got turned over and why SDNY didn't turn everything over at the start, but I did a post laying out possible reasons why they didn't.
Eight of
and
them.
And one of those, just as an example, is that the investigation of Michael Cohen, which is what Donald Trump and Alvin Bragg's office were both asking for from the start, the investigation of Michael Cohen in the Stormy Daniels hush payment cannot be separated from any investigation SDNY has conducted of Victor Vexelberg, who is a Russian oligarch, okay, and who was sanctioned in 2018. So, and the reason that's true is because the investigation into Stormy Daniels came out of a suspicious activity report from 2016, right? So Michael Cohen sets up the bank account in early 2016. He says, I'm using it for domestic real estate purposes. And then when he needs an account to basically launder the money to Stormy Daniels, he uses that essential consulting account. And because he's a politically exposed person, his bank is like, this isn't really what you said you were going to use it for. So they spend a suspicious, they send a suspicious activity report to the feds, and then the bank continues to investigate, and they find that after the election, Vexelberg starts paying Cohen like $80,000 a month for up to, you know, it ends up being $400,000. And as the investigation opened, and as Mueller was like, remember that the Russian investigation started trying to answer a question, which is who had advance notice of the Russian hack, such that George Papadopoulos knew about it in April before the Democrats did. And Michael Cohen became one potential suspect in that because he got these payments from Vexelberg. And so it's the same bank account. And the very first warrant targeting Michael Cohen, I linked it in my post, talks about both Stormy Daniels mm-hmm. and Victor Vexelberg, like right. the Mueller showed probable cause that Cohen was doing something for Vexelberg without registering as a foreign agent. So I mean, this is just a hypothetical, right. But we know that SDNY continues to investigate Vexelberg. They charged Vexelberg's the SDNY charged Vexelberg's American fixer, basically the guy who keeps Vexelberg's properties in the United States up for him. And then in December, DC charged the people who keeps Vexelberg's yacht up for him. This is in 2022 and 2023, mm-hmm. but there's stuff going on in the investigation of the fixer. We don't know what, it's all sealed. But there's a really interesting investigation going into Vexelberg's fixer, who's supposed to be a fugitive. He's not supposed to be in the United States. Something's going on. And so if, for example, those Vexelberg files on Cohen were deemed sensitive a year ago when Alvin Bragg first asked for the case file, you could understand why SDNY wouldn't want to turn it over.
Right.
I used a couple of other, I mean, like, we know that Bill Barr was investigated for some things. Probably, we don't know that this was included, but if it was, then that would be one reason they might not turn them over. There have been hints that SDNY was looking at Trump's finances. If that became an issue, then they might not turn over those files. So the point is that there are legitimate reasons why SDNY might not want to give the entire case file. Then Donald Trump subpoenaed, Donald Trump allowed them to delay, and that explains why we haven't gotten them. There's some subset of the files that Trump has gotten that weren't part of the request. They weren't part of, you know, like, 70,000 plus 15,000. So, you know, easily two-thirds of the new materials or more, almost three-quarters of the new materials are not stuff that were part of the case file that Alvin Bragg asked for a year ago.
Wow. Now, so this is complicated. In fact, your post, you say there are a number of possible explanations why SDNY delayed in turning over these files. And you say most of them are terrible, at least three defensible, but you list eight, one of them being protecting a Victor Vexelberg investigation. You have covering up Bill Barr's fuckery, covering up Ed O'Callaghan's fuckery. Well, I'll get back to that. Hiding details regarding the retraction of Robert Mueller's scope. Hiding details of Cohen's tax crimes. Hiding details of Barr's further fuckery. That deserves a little ding. protecting a Bill Barr investigation, the Victor Vexelberg investigation we mentioned, and protecting a Trump tax investigation. Who is Ed O'Callaghan?
Ed O'Callaghan, there's a position called PAYDAG, PADAG, okay. Principal Associate Deputy Attorney General. And that is the, you know, so the Deputy Attorney General is like the CEO of DOJ. The Attorney General isn't the one who does day-to-day things. So when people beat up on Merrick Garland, it's sort of nutty. It's like, no, Lisa Monaco is the one in charge. But so a Deputy Attorney General has a PADAG, a Principal Associate Deputy Attorney General, and they're the right-hand person. And so the ones that Rod Rosenstein and then Jeffrey Rosen had started with Robert Herr, the guy who just finished the investigation.
Oh, we're going to get to that, yes.
Joe Biden. And then Ed O'Callaghan took over. Oh. And then a guy by the name of Seth Ducharme took over. And then Richard Donahue took over. So Ed O'Callaghan, though, importantly, is the guy who oversaw the second half of the Mueller investigation and was really instrumental in kind of reining it in and pushing Mueller to shut it down. So Ed O'Callaghan was...
Yeah. Guilty of fuckery. And so this is
and his fuckery, like the fuckery in this case is that when remember when Michael Cohen pled guilty, he talked about individual wine. It was a big scandal.
Right.
So Ed O'Callaghan tried to force Jeffrey Berman, the U.S. attorney for SDNY, tried to force Jeffrey Berman to rewrite the entire information to take out any reference to individual one. Oh, and the reason why Trump wants these files is to be able to say the PADAG, one of the top people at DOJ, didn't think that Donald Trump was personally involved in the hush payment. Or, for example, again, in the Post, Bill Barr is so fucking crazy. People always never give him full credit for as corrupt as he is.
Right?
Bill Barr comes in. Michael Cohen has already been prosecuted, right? Already done. Prosecuted. He's going to jail.
Right.
And Bill Barr is like, do you think we can unprosecute Michael Cohen? He really did. He did. Like he
this
comes
is
in.
This is a two-time attorney general who asks this. I mean, you would think he would know.
Oh, yeah. He's like, can we unprosecute Michael Cohen? Because we don't think he should. We don't think that you should have a campaign finance crime because somebody laundered money to cover up a campaign finance crime. So Bill Barr says, can we unprosecute Michael Cohen? And Jeffrey Berman's like, no, we can't. And then Bill Barr's like, how about we put Richard Donahue, the U.S. attorney for EDNY. How about we put him in charge instead so I can ask him to unprosecute Michael Cohen? And Berman's like, no, you can't do that either. And he's like, how about if we write an OLC opinion saying you can't prosecute Donald Trump for the same crime that because they were still investigating. They were still doing this investigation of Donald Trump. And according to New York Times, and again, I linked this in my post, Barr did get OLC to write a memo, but not an opinion, basically saying we don't think that this should be prosecuted. And so Donald Trump is going to use this at this trial to say that the Attorney General of the United States decided to uncrime this. Like it had already been prosecuted. A judge had already said, cool, you're good. Guilty verdict from Michael Cohen. Right. And then Bill Barr comes in and literally, I mean, it's just insane. And Bill Barr is never held accountable for this stuff. So Bill Barr tries to unprosecute this stuff. And it is unclear whether that memo was turned over last year to Alvin Bragg or whether it's in the stuff that was more recently turned over. But that's what Trump wants. He wants to be able to say, Bill Barr said this is not a crime. And he wants to be able to say that Bill Barr's flunky tried to get all mention of individual one taken out of the criminal information. So that's the intent. But of course, Donald Trump is also trying to delay.
Well, of course, delay is the tactic. And in many cases, it's working. So this trial that was supposed to begin in 10 days, do we have a new day? Is it going to be April 25th or do we know yet?
This is what you're probably going to have to add at the end of the day on this podcast, because it's not, we haven't heard the judge yet.
And hopefully by the end of the day, by the time this airs at 5 Eastern, 2 Pacific, we'll know the answer to that. And I will update live. By the way, today is going to be another day like last week when I do an extended version, only because I'm going to play a little tribute to my friend, the late Angela McCluskey of the band Wild Colonials and telepop music, who died yesterday. So we're losing our friends and musical icons just at too quick a pace. So I got that news yesterday. So I will devote some time at the end of this. If you want to stay tuned for some really good music, we'll get to that. All right. So that's that. Let's keep on the Trump prosecutions. Yesterday was the long-awaited hearing in it was in Palm Beach County, I believe, in Fort Pierce, under Judge Aileen Cannon. This is the Mar-a-Lago secret documents case. Stolen documents case. Thank you. Stolen secret documents case.
Secret SCI, yes. Special compartment.
Exactly. And Judge Aileen Cannon was a Trump appointee who has been carrying water for him ever since this case came to light. She actually struck down one of Trump's arguments in which he sought to have charges dismissed. And we don't have an answer yet on the other one. What happened yesterday?
Not as of the moment that we're recording this. But even the one that she struck down, she's still playing Calvin Ball. So these are motions to dismiss. You're supposed to do them at the beginning. She let them get some discovery beforehand, supposed to do them at the beginning. And it was insane. Like, I've seen this motion to dismiss in, I've probably covered 20 Espionage Act cases. They try it in every single one. And in every single one, the judge says, no, sorry, not going to work. Not Judge Cannon. Judge Cannon says, well, maybe for Donald Trump, he's too stupid to know that the Espionage Act is going to get prosecuted. All these other people, these lowly, you know, these, you know, like the people who, you know, worked for DIA and shared some documents, or people, you know, like this Reality Winner,
right?
I'm sure Reality Winner tried this, didn't work for Reality Winner. So Reality Winner goes to prison for years because she is being held accountable for knowing that that the Espionage Act can apply to her.
Right.
But in spite of presiding over all these Espionage Act cases while he was president, Donald Trump is like, I'm too stupid to know. And Aileen Cannon is like, okay, you haven't made your argument now, but I'll let you revisit it at the trial. And this is what lawyers are really worried about, is that she's going to get mid-trial after the jury is already seated and say, I'm going to Calvin Ball everything and change the rules, dismiss the case, and then double jeopardy would prevent you from retrying it. So she is totally nuts. I mean, she like, part of me every once in a while thinks charitably of her and says maybe she's just trying to, like, make it appear that she is getting every consideration. Because, like, the hearing yesterday was stupid because this motion was stupid. Like, you know, the other motion that she heard yesterday was his argument that he can steal boxes of classified documents with impunity. He's basically saying that the Presidential Records Act, which was passed because Richard Nixon tried to steal documents, but not classified documents. So it applies to presidents. It's right there in the title.
Yes,
it's not
Presidential
Reality Winner Records Act. It's the Presidential Records Act. So passed to apply to presidents. Donald Trump is saying, well, it doesn't apply to me because I have basically converted all of these stolen documents to my personal property. And therefore I was perfectly right to take boxes and boxes of classified documents. The implications of Donald Trump's argument are insane. They're basically like, once you become a president, you can steal any number of classified documents you want and sell them to Russia to fund your next reelection campaign. That is literally what he is arguing.
He's saying
he can do anything with.
He is misinterpreting what the Presidential Records Act is, saying that it allows him to do this stuff and it does nothing of the sort.
Right. And Aileen Cannon should just blow it out of the water. But, you know, again, she's being Aileen Cannon. Now, one tiny good sign, of course, I wasn't at that hearing, but Roger Parloff, who always does superb work, he did a hearing, he did a podcast yesterday with Ben Wittes. He's such a good reporter on courtroom stuff, and he'll write it up, I think, today. So I would look out for his description. But, like, you know, and this is the point I'm about to make was made by an ABC reporter first, Catherine Falders, who's also a good reporter. But she made a point yesterday. They're like, we're talking about jury selection. We're talking about jury instructions. So finally, Aileen Cannon is to the point where she's at least envisioning a trial, which is, you know, it's a first step. Like, it's not going to, I don't think it's going to happen before the election. At this point, one of my biggest concerns about Cannon is that she will try and block Chutkan. There's almost certainly going to be a window for Chutkan to at least start the trial in September. Uh-huh. Or start jury selection in September. So Trump could spend all of October in trial.
Right.
And I could see Aileen Cannon trying to block it, trying to say, well, I'm going to take that scheduling period. And then, oh my gosh, having a delay come, right. You know. So that's my biggest concern at this point, because I just don't think it's going to go to trial, whereas Chutkan is going to take it to trial if she can. So that's where we're at.
And things, something that everyone should keep in mind is if Trump somehow gets reelected, all these go away. If he does not, if Biden wins, all these prosecutions will happen just after the election. The question is, do the American people have a right to hear these cases before they go to the ballot box? Obviously they do. He's doing everything he can to delay it so that they don't hear the cases against him. Yeah, it's sound. So a sidebar story to this document, stolen documents case, our mutual friend Jason Leopold, who these days is doing his work over at Bloomberg News and just launched a new newsletter, The FOIA Files, has in the one that came out today, it comes out every Friday, new details about the FBI search of Mar-a-Lago and the reports he got FOIA documents. I don't know if you've heard this yet or not. Jason will
No, I did read it. I was going to raise it, so I'm glad you did. I mean, these documents basically are like FBI agents going, how dare you investigate my BFS?
Yeah.
You know, it's just pathetic because they're like, I mean, look, they believed Trump because FBI agents are stupid and they believe what comes out of Donald Trump. And they're like, don't you remember Crossfire Hurricane? I'm like, I remember Crossfire Hurricane. Crossfire Hurricane wasn't an investigation into Donald Trump. Crossfire Hurricane was an investigation into the Trump coffee boy,
right?
Oh, sorry. It was into this guy who literally told the FBI that he thought it was a cool idea to give non-public information to known Russian spies. Like, if you are an FBI agent and you don't think that should be investigated. And also, by the way, this is Carter Page, was trying to monetize his access to Donald Trump. If you're a real Donald Trump supporter, you should care that these people are trying to sell access to Donald Trump to other people. I mean, Mike Flynn did it with Turkey. There's this great conversation between George Papadopoulos and one of the informants that the FBI threw at him where he's like, you know, I'm better off if Trump loses because I just want access. I don't want to work in the White House. I want to sell my access to Donald Trump. I want to monetize this. I mean, everyone, of course, you know, Paul Manafort was selling access to the Ukrainian oligarchs. Like, every single person that was investigated was trying to sell their access. Going back to Michael Cohen, like Vexelberg, he was going to sell access to Victor Vexelberg. Everyone was selling their access to Donald Trump. And if you're a real FBI agent, that should sober. You should think about that and go, wow, not only does it suck that everyone's trying to take advantage of Donald Trump, but this is a huge national security problem. And yet these stupid MAGA FBI agents are like, oh, you hurt my BFF. And it's like, get, you know, if we lose people like you, we should lose people like you, because you know why? You're not thinking at all intelligent.
No. And it's just a conflict of interest. That's the easiest thing to say. It's mind blowing that these are the people charged with protecting us. And yet their side screams about the deep state. You know, it's opposite world. But Jason Leopold will be on this program on Tuesday to talk about all this. So leave it to Jason to get the scoop.
Should be a great, yes. And you'll also talk about music.
Oh, always. We always talk about music. And I know he also was a fan of Wild Colonials. So yeah, Jason and I always wind up spending an inordinate amount of time talking music. And he's got the best band t-shirt collection of anybody in the world.
So he's got the FOIA rejections, the band t-shirt collections.
That's right.
I've never been to his place in LA, but he's got to have a lot of space to put all that together.
He does. He's so Jason will be here Tuesday. So put that in your book.
So watch it, because that should be good.
It will be good.
Will.
Okay, so that brings us to how the week began with Robert Herr on the
was
stand.
That this week?
That was this. That
was that?
That was Tuesday.
That day was
actually
connected to this day, because that was like 17 years ago.
Absolutely. And but a curious thing, before he was sworn in to testify before the House Judiciary Committee, he resigned from the Department of Justice. So he was testifying as a private citizen. Do we know what prompted that?
Probably that he didn't want a DOJ babysitter with him. John Durham actually did the same. And with John Durham, I found that there were several things that John Durham was asked in his testimony where he backed off of false claims he made in his report, because in his report, he still had immunity as a prosecutor, same with her.
Uh-huh.
And then in his testimony, there were a few things that I noted, and I know at least one other person noted, he stopped well short of some lies that he told in the report. And so Herr was more political than he should have been. I think he sort of was taken aback by how much Republicans didn't believe him. And so he kept trying to play up the things that were damning to Biden. And, you know, I thought the hearing was terrible, Nicole, because both sides were focusing only on the presidential campaign. So
right.
Like the Democrats were repeatedly saying, did Biden do X, Y, and Z? No, he didn't. Well, Donald Trump did.
Mm-hmm.
There is a great moment where Eric Swalwell was like, did Biden do this? No. Did Biden do this? No. Did Biden do this? No. Did Biden do this? Well, Donald Trump is alleged to have done that. Can you agree now that you won't take a position in the Donald Trump administration? And that really threw Herr for a loop. That was like the highlight. There were two highlights, from my opinion, in the hearing. And that was one.
Well, here, because you brought it up, this is that moment.
Okay. He was impeached for leveraging $350 million U.S. taxpayer dollars over Ukraine to get dirt on President Biden. He was then impeached a second time for inciting an insurrection. Mm-hmm. He was charged for possessing classified documents and obstructing justice. He was charged for paying for the silence of a porn star. He was charged in Georgia for his role in January 6. He was charged in the District of Columbia for his role in January 6. He owes $400 million to the state of New York for defrauding the state through his taxes. And he has been judged a rapist. You want to be perceived, understandably, as credible. And so I want to first see if you will pledge to not accept an appointment from Donald Trump if he is elected again as president.
Congressman, I'm not here to testify
about
what will happen in the
future. Considering what I just laid out.
I'm here to talk about the report and the work that went into it.
But you don't want to be associated with that guy again, do you?
Congressman, I'm not here to offer any opinions about what may or may not happen in the future. I'm here to talk about the work that went into the report, which I stand by.
Yeah. So that happened. What was your other standout moment?
I don't remember who it was, Congresswoman, maybe Dean?
Madeline
but
Dean.
Do you have this one too?
I do. I think you're asking.
You're so good.
I think you're asking about this clip.
Give you a chance, since the transcript is out, to correct the record on an important point. Very sadly, your report on page 208 says that Mr. Biden couldn't come up with the date, the year of his son, Beau Biden's death, when in fact in the transcript it shows that you asked him the month. And do you know what he said, Mr. Herr? He said, oh God, May 30th. Would you like to correct the record? His memory was pretty firm on the month and the day.
Congresswoman, I don't believe that's correct with respect to the transcript, but if you could refer me to a specific page, I'd be happy to look.
Okay.
And my second document, to clarify for you, sir, Mr. Herr, from the transcription, page 82, the words are President Biden's. What month did Beau die? Oh, God, May 30th. A searing memory. I ask unanimous consent.
Without objection.
So So that happened. I have one more that also came from Eric Swalwell that I had no idea, and I guess nobody did until we got the transcripts. And Eric Swalwell's staff must have poured through them because there was not much time between when the transcripts were released and the hearing. But it was this moment.
I now want to turn you to the transcript and day one, page 47. You said to President Biden, you have appear to have a photographic understanding and recall of the House. Did you say that to President Biden?
Those words do appear on page 47 of the transcript.
Photographic is what you said. Is that right?
Photographic.
That word does appear on page 47 of the transcript.
Never appeared in your report, though. Is that correct? The word photographic?
That does not appear in my report.
No, in fact, his report, his findings were this is a senile elderly man with a poor memory who will be, you know, sympathetic to a jury, so we can't bring charges because he doesn't remember anything. Photographic. What?
Yeah, and one thing I wrote a post. I was like, I was giggling through the whole hearing. And the reason why is because her reportedly got Sarah Isger, who when he was at Maine DOJ was the spokesperson for DOJ. And she's famous, most notably with Peter Strzok's tests, right? So she would say, well, I'm going to release them to Congress, but then pre-release them to the press.
Uh-huh.
So Sarah Isger did with Peter Strzok's texts what somebody, and we don't know whether it was the White House or whether it was the DOJ, did with those transcripts, because Jim Jordan had asked for the transcripts, was waiting for the transcripts, and then DOJ, or the White House, again, we don't know which side, make sure that just the Democrats have the transcripts, and they release it to a bunch of journalists. All the journalists, even the shitty ones, are like, the transcript actually makes Biden look a lot better than her. And that all happened just as her was arriving in the hearing room. And then I didn't get advance notice because I'm not, you know, the New York Times. But the transcripts, you know, and so you had moments like that where her was asked about things in the transcripts and he was like, because he had not reviewed the transcripts.
Right.
And honestly, my suspicion is that 20 years from now, we'll learn that he had another former U.S. attorney for part of Iowa who was on his team by the name of Mark Crickbaum. And my guess is Mark Crickbaum was the really like flaming partisan on the team. And because it shows up in the transcript, I did a post on how they tried to sandbag Biden, and Biden was like, at one point Biden's like, you know, I used to teach logic and you guys are failing. I mean, he didn't say you're failing, but he's like, I used to teach logic and your logic isn't working, because they literally came in there. They said, here, we have a theory that will criminalize the fact that there are Afghan documents that we can't even prove were in the Virginia House when you said, I found some classified documents downstairs. We cannot prove that. But here's our theory to try and claim that you did. Mm. And Biden was like, but your theory is stupid because it's more likely that the box never went into the house, just got dropped off there. And I don't know where it came from. I didn't pack the boxes. And so you really saw how they tried. I mean, at one point, Crickbaum, the guy I talked to, the other U.S. attorney, says, do you remember asking your ghostwriter, saying to your ghostwriter, I just found these marked classified documents downstairs. And Biden says, marked. And Crickbaum, his name is Mark, and so is the ghostwriter, was like, oh, yeah, you know, your ghostwriter named Mark, and kind of elides the fact that he just invented something that wasn't in the transcript. Dirty, dirty, dirty pool. And Biden was like, hold on a second. And through it all, Bob Bauer, who is Biden's personal attorney, was like, hold on a second. Don't ask the president to speculate. Your job is to ask the president what he remembers, not to ask what he speculates. So they catch him. They catch her and Crickbaum over and over and over again, trying to sandbag the president. And Biden wasn't having it. I mean, like, Bauer wasn't having it. But even Biden on his own was like, no, your logic doesn't make any sense. Here's a better theory. And it shows quite clearly, which we knew from a letter that Biden's attorneys had written, we knew that Biden had said, when he was asked, what do you think you were referring to when you said that you found classified documents downstairs? He's like, the memo that I sent Obama, which in context is exactly what he said, what he was referring to. But in the report itself, her only includes that context once. You know, he mentions it, I counted, I think it's 27 times.
Oh my God.
He only mentions the full context once. So most readers aren't going to understand that in context, it's clearly a reference to the memo that Biden sent Obama. And then, and Biden answered, and by the way, Crickbaum didn't read the full context. I think that, I think it's like 66 words or something, the full quote. He only read the eight line, the eight quotes. So he didn't read, he did say, you know, you were talking about this memo you sent Obama, but even without the full context, the old geezer was smart enough to say, I probably was referring to the memo. And the reason why the memo is important is because the, you know, they kept inventing these motives. Like, well, we think that you brought the Afghan documents home to write a book about Afghanistan. And Biden's like, well, I didn't write a book about Afghanistan. I never had a plan to write a book about Afghanistan. And so then they retreat and they're like, well, then we think you brought these Afghan books, these Afghan documents home because you wanted to be vindicated. And I'm like, why would he ever need any other documents? Like, the best vindication you can have is proof that you, in handwriting, put together a 40-page memo, wrote it up over Thanksgiving while you were supposed to be vacationing with your family in Nantucket, and sent it, faxed it to Barack Obama, and then flew frantically to try and talk Barack Obama out of surging troops in Afghanistan, which, oh, by the way, Biden was right about. But yes. You don't, there's never, you wouldn't need any more vindication. And so their motive was asinine. And you know, they applied standards with those, with that box in the garage, different standards than that. Like, there was a box of more sensitive documents that they found in Penn Center, and their theory for how those ended up there was they got moved to the Naval Observatory for a meeting to try and convince Lindsey Graham to support the Iran deal. And then they never got moved back to the White House. So that's how that box landed there. My suspicion is the how the Afghan documents didn't get carried back was that they were in Nantucket with Biden while he wrote this memo. And because Biden didn't, because Biden went back separately, those documents didn't go back to where they were supposed to. And they just kept getting transferred on. But there's, but the point is, there was never a motive for Biden to take them, because all the vindication you would want is the memo you sent to the president of the United States saying, do not search troops in Afghanistan.
Wow. And again, I refer people back to emptywheel.net, where you wrote this post a couple of days ago, how alleged geezer Joe Biden caught Rob Hur and Mark Crickbaum trying to sandbag him. Plain English, you get at emptywheel.net. Now, you,
I mean, it was like the transcript really makes them look stupid. And that's sort of my point. It's like the old, they called him a geezer because he made them look stupid. And so, yeah, whoever did release the transcripts and just to Democrats was brilliant. And I'm, like I said, I was giggling the whole time because it really made her look stupid.
Yeah. And this is the thing. So his whole report that it says, you know, Joe Biden's this elderly, senile old man who, you
geezer. But he made you look stupid.
So, but when you read the transcript, a reasonable person would probably come to a different conclusion. And that's just astounding to me. And it, you know, it harkens back to Bill Barr and his interpretation of the Mueller report before we ever had a chance to read it, right? So they say one thing and then figure that the American people just won't read the full report. So this, but take our word for it. Well, this is what it found.
Yeah. But honestly, I, you know, this is one of the reasons I thought the hearing sucked, because Democrats, you know, Eric Swalwell notwithstanding,
right.
And Madeleine Dean notwithstanding, I think that there was an argument there. They should have made at least some effort to say, you know, to do what I've just done, which is, how dumb is it to think that Joe Biden would have brought these classified right. documents home when he had the memo? Why did you treat Reagan's diaries as diaries and Joe Biden's diaries, his notebooks, and use that as an excuse to read through all of them. Like, that question should have been asked.
Right.
And her got one question about Reagan, but didn't really get taken. Like, his double standard on Reagan was just was grotesque, especially because in the transcript, Biden at one point is like, makes that argument. He's like, you know, Reagan brought his diaries home too. That's so right. It wasn't just an argument that Biden's lawyers made after the fact. He's like, I brought the diaries home because vice presidents and presidents bring their diaries home. There's a long tradition of it, and it happens. So, and you know, when you read the Hur report, even without that, you know that he's scrambling to try and make a crime out of bringing these diaries home. And he was never going to be able to do that because Biden said, you know, and the Presidential Record Act says, like, diaries are excluded right. from the Presidential Records Act. Stolen documents, not excluded.
So much.
You know, diaries are. So I wish that Democrats would have laid out how shoddy the report was for other reasons, because, like, just as an example, and this is my pet peeve, the 793, the elements of the offense are, one, did you bring national defense stuff home wittingly?
Okay.
Okay. So it has to be national defense. So, like, nuclear documents count, the Afghan documents probably make sense. But one of the things Hur noted is these were pretty dated. The Iran documents that got moved to Penn Center clearly would count. So, one, did you bring them home? Two, did they qualify as national defense information? But there's a third element, which is, did you refuse to give them back?
Which is what Trump did, and Biden, when they realized they had them, called the National Archives and said, we have this stuff.
Right, right. And so you could never have proven that. And in fact, the line that Hur tried to use, I just found these classified documents in the basement, the other better possibility for what the classified documents were is that weeks before that, Biden had found a list of names of class, you know, sources or something that was more sensitive than the Afghan documents, had found it and sent it back.
Right.
So contextually, he may well have been referring to that. And the fact that he had just sent classified documents back is proof that he wouldn't just keep them, or it's pretty good evidence that he wouldn't just keep them. And there was a conversation about the standard. Some Democrat got the standard wrong. You know, somebody should have, like, I just want somebody who has a JD. Like, I have covered 20 of these cases. I wrote up exactly how it was possible to charge Donald Trump way in advance because he didn't give the documents back. That's how you get that element of offense with the president. Who normally what happens is if you have clearance and you leave a job, they say, do you have any classified? They sort of say they clear you out of your clearance and they say, give all your documents back. And then if you still have them, that's what they use to prove that you didn't give them back to somebody qualified to have them. But here, it's really hard to prove the case against presidents because no one ever asks them to give documents back. They find them, they send them back. They find them, they send them back.
Except in the case of Donald Trump.
Except in the case of Donald Trump. I mean, he was asked over and over again to give them back and he refused. And, you know, and this Calvin ball that Aileen Cannon is playing, she wants to get to the trial and say, well, maybe the National Archives isn't qualified to be the people who send them back. Or maybe the FBI isn't counted among the people who can demand that you send them back. So.
Yeah. To be continued, right? I also want to point out, you have another post up, and it covers a lot of what we've discussed this morning or afternoon or whatever time it is where you are when you're listening. What if the problem is not with special counsels, but instead the presidency? Explain.
Well, that was my intro post, and if you go there, you can... That links back to all the other posts I wrote about Hur. I think so. You know, a couple of people who used to be DOJ attorneys are like, "Well, obviously the special counsel regulations aren't working. Donald Trump has a challenge to special counsel regulations. Hunter Biden does." And this was interesting. He had a I didn't write this up in a post, but he had a status hearing on, I don't know, I've lost track. sometime this week. And the judge, like Abby Lowell, his very good lawyer, is like, hey, judge, we really need you to issue the opinion on the fact that Hunter Biden signed a contract and David Weiss reneged on the contract. That's the first one you need to right. decide on, because right. everything else, like if you decide that that's true, you don't have to decide anything else, because then everything else falls apart. But she sort of said, well, I actually have a clarification question that I'm going to issue that you need to fill on the special counsel, on Hunter Biden's challenge to the special counsel. Now, all of these special counsel challenges suck. They're not going to work. It's not going to work. You know, Abby Lowell is a great lawyer. Not going to work mm-hmm. for him, I'm mm-hmm. sure. But, and Donald Trump's are going to work even less well, because Merrick Garland adhered to the rules on, he brought somebody in from the outside to investigate Donald Trump. With David Weiss, there's a problem, because David Weiss was already investigating and then demanded to be made a special counsel and then got these extra authorities. Now we know that was probably so that he could investigate Joe Biden. But the judge Mary Ellen Noreika, who's in Delaware, she was like, well, I've got some clarification questions. So I'm sort of interested in that, because Hunter Biden's is not going to work. Abby Lowell, good lawyer, still not going to work because of the way special counsels work. But it is actually, there are problems. There's a lot of problems with David Weiss's appointment as special counsel. And then there are problems when you get to the fact that Alexander Smirnoff, David Weiss is a witness against Alexander Smirnoff. He's a witness of the way in which Bill Barr, this comes full circle. It's always about Bill Barr, because it's Bill Barr. David Weiss is a witness to the way that Bill Barr set up this side channel to frame Joe Biden. And so David Weiss has absolutely no business being in charge of this investigation.
Right.
None. Because he's a witness to being ordered by the PAYDAG, at that point it was Richard Donahue, to do further investigation. He is the one who bowed to Republican pressure to reopen the investigation and to consider whether Joe Biden actually did get bribed. Wow. And so David Weiss can't be in charge of that investigation. And I keep saying it, but until louder people say it, or until somebody says it to Merrick Garland, there's a problem, because Abby Lowell's going to say it, and he's smarter than I am. So, and he's also happens to be a lawyer. So yes. Maybe he'll get away. Maybe people will start paying attention to Abby Lowell, but this is a problem. My point was that we still haven't been able to figure out what the appropriate way to investigate presidents are. And, we'll get some of this clarity when the Supreme Court rules in June in their last ruling of the year.
Yep.
We'll get some clarity with whatever appeals are made of Aileen Cannon's stupid decisions. We'll get clarity, if anything else comes out of Judge Chicken. We're going to get some clarity, right? Bizarrely, Trump hasn't challenged the ability to be prosecuted in Georgia yet, but he might now that Fani Willis lives to fight another day.
Right.
But because he can. I mean, the D.C. Circuit, when they ruled, they said this is not to say that he can be charged by a state. Maybe he can't be charged by a state on things that happen. Like, so Trump could still appeal being charged by Georgia because he can't be charged for a state for something that was an official act. So, he'll be in the courts forever. So we'll see some clarity about, what you can charge a president for and what you can't charge a president for. But we still don't have a good way to investigate them, because these special counsel reports, no one's ever been happy with them.
Mm-hmm.
I think Mueller is widely misunderstood. I think that the fact that David Weiss will have the ability to write a report about the president's son based off chasing Russian disinformation is obscene.
Yes.
And I think, it may actually become useful. Like, if Jack Smith thinks he's not going to get a trial, one thing he could do is issue a report and go out in glory, on August 31st. On the other charges,
charges, right? I mean, he could.
Yeah, I mean, I would prefer that he bring other charges if it feels like he's not going to get to trial.
Right.
But the point is that we just haven't figured out how to keep presidents within the rule of law.
Right. And especially when you have Donald Trump arguing that he should be above the law, that he did, that the president needs immunity or he can't do his job, which is bullshit.
Well, and partly it's that Donald Trump succeeded in politicizing DOJ. He's not the first person, but Bill Barr, you know, is an expert at it. And, you know, Trump has promised he'll do worse if he gets in again.
Yeah.
And he, you know, so we need to fix that.
We do.
You need to, and, you know, and it comes amid, it comes in a period where everyone has lost faith in the, you know, those stupid FBI agents that Jason Leopold discovered. You hurt my BFF. You held him accountable for the rule of law.
My favorite was one who said, you know, so he had documents. So ask him to return them. You don't search his residence. Well, they did ask him. Hello.
A million times. Yeah. Right. I hope that guy is embarrassed now.
God, I hope so too. I hope so. Jason again on the show on Tuesday. So Marcy, you mentioned Hunter Biden, our obligatory mention of Hunter Biden. Now he's saying no, he will not come and testify publicly.
Yes. So James Comer again invited him. Now I'm gonna mention something. So I think on the 6th, James Comer calls the hearing, invites these mostly indicted, mostly convicted people, and then Tony Bobulinski, who claims the FBI lied about what he said, all 9 of them, right? So Tony Bobulinski pre-indicted, everyone else convicted. That's going to be the hearing. And then he says, okay, Hunter, you can show up. And Abby Lowell says 3 things. One, we already have a date. Hunter Biden and I already have a court hearing to be at. Mm-hmm. 2, here's all the reasons why this is garbage. We already, you know, sat for 6 hours of deposition. Right. We already answered all your questions. And 3, if you invite Jared Kushner, if you prove that you are engaged in a legislative purpose rather than the impeachment inquiry, great, we'll show. Invite Jared Kushner, I will show. If you invite all these other pre- and post-indicted people, we're not going to show. And so that's, and by the way, the White House yesterday or today sent a letter to James Comer saying, sorry, impeachment over. So you can't continue to get all these documents. Impeachment is over. It's over. Goodbye. So basically, I think they're going to say, if you want to get, if you want to be treated as an impeachment, you're going to have to get another vote, which of course they can't because Ken Buck left. They, you know, only have a 2-vote majority at this point, so not going to happen. But so back to Abby Lowell, back to the letter. And here's why it's interesting is that they did have a court date. They did have a court hearing. The hearing is going to be the 20th, so next week sometime. And they, at that point, when he sent the letter, were scheduled for the motion to dismiss hearing in the Garrett Ziegler lawsuit. Remember, Hunter Biden is suing Garrett Ziegler for, among other things, hacking his phone,
a phone that
was embedded in the laptop that was embedted in the. What's interesting is they don't have that court hearing anymore. After he sent the letter yesterday, Abby Lowell sent a letter to the court, to the judge, saying, you know, Garrett Ziegler is trying to recuse you. We would rather have the recusal done before the hearing. So we consent to move that hearing to April. So I don't rule out, it is not impossible that they could show up and be in the audience again, which would be hilarious.
Oh,
but,
wow. Do we know when that hearing is? Do we have a date?
Yes. The Comer hearing is... Yeah, the Comer hearing is the 20th.
Oh, okay. All right.
So next week.
Yep. Next Wednesday. All right. Well, stay tuned. Marcy Wheeler, it is this Sunday is St. Patrick's Day. It's a circus over here. I'm wondering what it's like in Ireland.
It is Sunday. I thought it was, I happened to drive home today. I'm driving now. I can drive with my foot now.
Yay.
I was driving home during pickup time, which in Ireland is like that's when the traffic jams happen.
Oh, pick up the kids from school time. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm driving through school pickup time and all of the children are wearing like these two girls had these most crazy green dresses, like head to toe green flared tutu dresses.
Right.
And that's so Monday is a bank holiday for us because that's for that. So it's a 3-day weekend. So that's why all the children were wearing green today. It is. When I was 16, I came with my family because I'm Irish American. I came with my family to Ireland and we showed up on St. Patrick's Day. We lived in New York State at the time. Uh-huh. And so we're in Dublin on St. Patrick's Day and everyone is like, why the fuck would you come from New York from New York to Dublin for St. Patrick's Day? Everyone knows that it's a lot more fun to be in New York for St. Patrick's Day or Chicago. It is a bigger deal now. There is a parade here with bands and all the trappings of a parade. So it is a bigger deal. But it's also a bank holiday, so a lot of people are just going to, you know, leave town and go party somewhere else for the weekend. So, it's a 3-day weekend for us. All the children are wearing green.
Oh, it's
adorable. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Yes, to you too. I have a great St. Patrick's Day story. Some years ago, I was Randy Rhodes' regular guest host, and she, they called me to guest host for her one day. I don't remember what the reason was, but I said, I would love to, but I'm flying to New York that morning. I think it was like tomorrow. And, you know, so they said, what time do you land? I said, I don't know, like 9 or 10. They said, okay, so if you go right to Rockefeller Center, the studios are above Radio City Music Hall. And I'm like, sure, okay, I'll do that. That'll be fun. And it happened to be St. Patrick's Day. And the cab
you can't get
driving
there.
Through. Well, we got there in time. But New York City on St. Patrick's Day, there's nothing like it.
Did they
it.
Send you a car at least? So it was NBC's?
No, but I think they reimbursed me for the cab fare. Okay. But it was a cab from the airport. But once we hit the city, the streets everywhere, people on the streets drinking beer, dressed in green, partying. It's a scene. So I'm guessing it's similar.
I used to go to Chicago's. Like I've been to Chicago's maybe three times.
The river goes green.
Yeah, the river goes green. Like once I accidentally went. I'm trying to remember her name. She a blogger from originally from Wisconsin, but who lived in Chicago, who wrote a book on the historic Irish pubs of Chicago. Gosh, I'm forgetting her name, and it's pissing me off because it's a great book. But it was sort of interesting because like. You know, Irish pubs in Chicago, big deal, you know, almost as big, like we have some good Irish pubs here too, but she was describing how she had to go to this Irish pub in a mostly African-American part of South Chicago, but you had to be invited to get in. It was all the crooked white cops, right? And so she walked in and she was highly uncomfortable being there because she was not a crooked white cop, a crooked Irish-American cop, right? So I came for her book release, which was at the Irish American Center north of downtown in Chicago, not realizing that it was St. Patrick's Day weekend. And that's when I brought my spouse, who of course is Irish. And he was like, so disgusted by the American scene of drunk of people pretending to be Irish, vomiting everywhere.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's what it equates with here. Even before, you know, doing the political talk, I did music radio. I used to work with Mark and Brian in Los Angeles. And every year on St. Patrick's Day, we would do the drunk show where from 6 to 10 a.m., they would drink shots and get progressively drunker as the morning goes on. I've got a plaque somewhere from the city of Los Angeles for the public service we did.
I heard that back in the day.
Probably, because it got a lot of publicity, and I still hear about that from listeners, and that's going back over 30 years. So it's not all about drinking, but it is. I guess it is.
It is. And people, I mean, I was saying this to other people. I mean, like, in the United States, white working class people so often take their identity from being Irish, however little Irish they have. Like that's, you know, going back to the Civil War, you had this creation of race around the conflict between Irish immigrants and freed slaves, right? That's historic fact. And that continues for years where you've got, you know, the white working class people who are the Irish and you've got the freed slaves and this built-in conflict to get them to hate and at times kill each other. And then the Irish Americans turn into the cops, of course. And still to this day, like, you know, where my dad grew up, we have family members, it's easier to become a cop if you're part of that Irish American network, right? And they became cops. So I think that there is this historical marking of white working class people being Irish, however little or much that they are. And, you know, as I described, like, the Irish are like the Mormons. They make genealogy really easy. So if you've got that part of Irish American blood, you can go find people. And then if you look at American foreign tourism, they go to places where they can speak English, right? So Americans are more like Republicans are going to go to Ireland because they don't have to bother learning any French or Spanish, right? So they'll go. I mean, I remember tracking this in the aughts, like at that point, because my spouse and I came to Ireland. We decided to throw his parents an anniversary party, a wedding anniversary party, and surprise them. So we arrived in Shannon and went to Doolin and went out to a bar. This was during the Iraq War, and all of the people there were Republicans, American Republicans. Yeah. And my spouse, you know, he was like, there are maybe five of these moments in our lives where he was like, just don't start a brawl. Just do not get in a fight. Just, you know, and I actually, they were interesting people, like, but they were arch conservative Republicans. Most were really into the war. And so, you know, so Americans will travel to Ireland. There's golf, there's English. And they, when they travel here, will find that. And I mean, I did it when I was 16, when I came to Dublin and should have been in New York celebrating St. Patrick's Day in New York, that they will find, because my dad was Republican, we would find the relatives in, you know, what we had like relatives in four counties. Now we know, and you'd go find your ancestry. Right. And so it's so built in that anybody with any drop of Irish blood now, you know, like almost all of my ancestors are Irish. So it was like, that's why we have all these counties. But and that's why that, you know, and so it's so easy for people to pretend to be Irish as an excuse to get drunk on St. Patrick's Day. You know?
And many who aren't do as well.
Yeah. I mean, you don't need to be anymore, but like I mean, honestly, like there's a lot of Bill O'Reilly racism tied to being Irish American.
Oh God. Yes, right.
There is.
Well, yes.
And yeah, I mean, it's something like even my father-in-law who has passed, but my father-in-law would always ask me about it. It's like about precisely that conflict between freed slaves and Irish workers. And it really is a big part of American history. You know, I'm really happy to be in Ireland. And I was raised Irish American and it's fun, but that's the kind of cultural baggage that goes into St. Patrick's Day.
And all the people screaming about immigration right now, you know, you go back and the Irish were the original immigrants who were illegal. Discriminated.
And they still are. Right. Like every time we have a debate about immigration reform, there's always the Republicans are always like, well, we're going to put these quotas on immigrants, on migrants, but not the illegal. There's always still in the United States, there's always a large number of illegal Irish immigrants. Oh, you know, they go and work on Nantucket for the summer or what have you. But they never get treated the same way, say Mexicans or Venezuelans or what have you.
White.
They always get treated specially because they're Republican constituencies.
Yeah.
And they're white. They're coded as white. Right?
Exactly. Right. Exactly. Well, no one ever said it was fair. Life is not fair.
No.
Nothing's fair these days. Marcy Wheeler, always a pleasure. I love Fridays for a number of reasons, but especially since you're here. And we get to sort of recap what happened and look ahead to the next week. And we'll figure out next week. Thank you, Marcy. Happy St. Patrick's
Day. And happy St. Patrick's Day.
You too. All right. We'll talk later. Bye. Don't forget, stick around because we're going to go into music and talk about my late friend, Angela McCluskey. We will. But before we get there, thanks again to Marcy Wheeler. I'm back live. It is Nicole here. We're in overtime now. And as I mentioned at the top of the show, I'm going to do a special thing for my friend Angela, who we lost yesterday. But as Marcy and I said, by the time the show ends today, we should know the new trial date for the Manhattan fraud trial of Donald Trump. You know, the the hush money payment trial? Well, we don't quite have the new date yet, but the judge has officially delayed Trump's Manhattan trial until at least mid-April. Again, DA Alvin Bragg said he would agree to a 30-day delay, which would bring us to mid-April, April 15th. So the judge scheduled a hearing. The original hearing was scheduled for March 25th. Again, there's no date certain yet, but it'll be, I guess, sometime after April 15th, which is 30 days from now. So that's what we have. Okay. Now, on to this. You know, it was just yesterday Howie Klein was here. Howie Klein, my regular guest every Thursday, who these days lives in the world of progressive politics. He runs the Blue America Pack, and he blogs at downwithtyranny.com. But I first met Howie over 30 years ago when we were both living in Los Angeles. I was doing music radio. Howie was president of Reprise Records. And because the station that I worked at starting in July of 1994 was a very adventurous music station, I got to know Howie pretty well back then. And then, you know, in this current life, we reconnected over politics. So yesterday we were talking, this has been a brutal week, that I mentioned that on Monday night, my friend Dan Navarro, who I hadn't seen in many years, was over for dinner. Dan is a singer-songwriter. He was in a duo called Lowen and Navarro. You might know them, but even if you don't, Eric Lowen, his partner, died a dozen years ago already from ALS. My goodness, how time flies. But you do know them because of some of the songs they wrote. One in particular, they wrote the song We Belong that became a huge hit for Pat Benatar and now has this resurgence. So it's being used in movies and film and TV shows and everywhere. And that's a good thing because Dan is finally getting a payday. And Eric Lowen's survivors, he had triplets, I guess he's now able to, take care of them in the afterlife. But we were talking. So he was over for dinner on Monday night and we talked for hours because it had been a long time since we'd seen each other. And at one point, of course, I opened my phone because we're all addicted, right? And I'm scrolling and I'm like, oh my God. And I saw that Eric Carmen had died. Eric Carmen, again, I, loved his music with the Raspberries. Just power pop, pure great power pop. And so, it was like, oh God, they're dropping like flies. And then I scrolled a little more and I saw that Carl Wallinger died. Now he's not as much of a household name, but World Party and the Water Boys before that, but World Party, I was a huge fan. And that just sort of was like a gut punch. And so Dan and I were talking about how we're losing our friends and colleagues and musical icons and how it's important to, as Warren Zevon said, enjoy every sandwich. Last night over dinner, I again opened up the phone and my heart stopped. My stomach fell because I read my friend Lily Hayden had posted that Angela McCluskey was gone. And this came out of nowhere. Angela McCluskey was the lead singer of a band called Wild Colonials back in the 90s. When I had been producing the Mark and Brian show for 4 years, we were the number one morning show in LA, and I took a big chance and I left to go be part of this startup to start this new radio station, KSCA, although at the time we didn't have the call letters yet. It was Southern California's album alternative. The old call letters, it was K-Lite. The call letters were K-L-I-T, and we used to joke, you wear your pleasure button on the FM dial. Anyway, it became KSCA, FM 101.9, and it was the format's AAA, adult album alternative, and it was about good music, first and foremost. And when the station launched, I was doing middays. We played, the library was filled with music that I loved because I'm a music person first and foremost. And then we played a lot of new music. I mean, this station broke artists like Dave Matthews and Sheryl Crow and, God, so many others, and Wild Colonials. So they had just released their first album. And one of the currents that was in rotation was a song called Heaven and Hell. Well, I found a fax in among my papers that I held on to all these years. And it's dated July 6th. 1996, and the station signed on the air July 1st, 1996. So we'd been on for 5 days, and I get this fax, and it says in beautiful handwriting, "Dear Nicole, there I was washing the kitchen floor, feeling very much full of the Wednesday blues. And you played Heaven and Hell and said such wonderful things about our album that I cheered up." Cheered up immediately and left the kitchen, headed out to the garden with a dry martini in my nightdress and soak up the beautiful LA sun. Thank you. Look forward to meeting you soon. Always, Angela, Wild Colonials, PS, love your show. And the rest, as they say, is history. They'd come on the station. They became like our house band, and Angela became a dear, dear friend. So what I thought I would do today is, because a lot of people are not familiar with their music or her music, is play one of those music hall sessions. And so the date, by this time, it was December 9th, 1996. The station would be sold just 2 months later, 6 weeks later. We went off the air at the beginning of February of 97. So we already knew the end was coming. Excuse me. Was she married and have children? She didn't have children. She married Paul Cantillon, who you will hear is a member of the band. In fact, the photograph that's up on the screen on the left, if you're watching a video, is us at an in-store appearance at Tower Records on Sunset Boulevard. That's Angela to the left of me and Paul to the right of me, as you're looking at the photo. I'm wearing some big white flowy thing for some reason. I guess I was trying to be like Angela or something. I don't know. But they later got married, but you'll hear them both on there. So no kids. But anyway, I hope you enjoy Wild Colonials in the FM 101.9 music hall. I think. Why is it not playing? Hold on. Why is it not playing? Okay, so this is weird. Oh, I know, because at the beginning of the show we had echo, 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 and I fixed everything. Hold on, I gotta unfix it so you can hear it. Okay, take two. Wild Colonials in the KSCA Music Hall, December 9th, 1996.
Okay. Hey. KSCA Glendale, idea. Los Angeles, FM 101.9. We are live in the Music Hall.
What an idea.
It sounds like a backstage vibe thing happening.
This is the most fun I've had with my clothes on.
The Wild Colonials really are wild.
Yeah,
you're not,
man.
In the band, please get out. You're not in the band. Please get out.
Okay. Need to get out.
Got it? Are we all set?
Get it, yeah. Got it, good.
Right. Okay, boy, that was a real, you know, like rock and roll
moment.
Vibe going on there.
Moment.
We are in the FM 101.9 Music Hall, welcoming back the Wild Colonials. I don't know, this is like your 35th visit or something like that.
I think so, yeah.
Is it our 35th visit?
Something like that. You know, actually, when your first album, Fruit of Life, came out, it was just about the same time that this radio station was born, in 1994. And in fact, our very first live broadcast was the in-store that you guys did at Tower Records on Sunset. We broadcast your whole set
That's
live.
Right.
That was our first broadcast. That's when we first met.
Mm.
Wow. And here we are.
Here we are.
2.5 years later.
Smoking
and,
cigarettes. holding.
No, we're the new album cigarettes. Is called This Can't Be Life, The Wild Colonials.
This Can't Be Life.
And you know, you've come so far, but everything remains the same in many ways.
Older and wiser and thinner, a wee bit thinner. That's a bit bigger.
Bigger. I was going to say bigger. In fact, you know, with the first album, we hoarded you. You were our band.
You
we had you exclusively. And now, like K-Rock has finally gotten Smark, and they're playing your record too, so we know that you've hit the big time. Anyway,
you've discovered this.
We did. You've always been ours. You played the Coach House last night. Here it was a wonderful show. And then you head to the Troubadour on the Thursday. Mm-hmm. This finally, you're back in town after an East Coast residency tour. We missed you.
I know. It was wild, man. We were out there for a long time.
How long?
Three and a half months. With hardly any days off.
And you did, what was it, like six cities?
We did Boston, Philadelphia. Actually, we did every city on the East Coast. We ended up in Baltimore, New Jersey, Vermont.
Vermont.
I'm hitting everything.
You're hitting everything.
But didn't you do a thing where
every Tuesday in Philly, every Wednesday New York City, every Friday Providence, every Saturday Boston, drive back down to New York City, and then start it all over again. So we were on the road every day, but it was...
Got to be exhausting, but it sounds like fun.
It was fun.
Good idea for any bands out there listening. Go do it. I mean, it's kind of expensive, but, you know.
And then we went out to Seattle, and we owned Boise.
Cool.
Boise.
We own Boise.
Well, the Wild Colonials are with us, and you're all ready to play a song, so what are you going to start with?
Koi, I think. Koi. For you, Nicole. This is
Thank
for you.
You. I love this song. It's from This Can't Be Life, the Wild Colonials on FM 101.9.
You drive me mad. All you do is smile. It's me that's twisted, set in bed. You should run a mile. Try to be a better soul. Love you just the same. All I wanna be is whole. Stop playing this game. Now we're at a crossroads. Time to make a choice. Can't direct your moral code.
Yeah. tears, doesn't it? Oh, Koi is the name of that song. Well, let me introduce the band here, because we are filled, we're in a room filled with multi-instrumentalists, very talented people, and not only talented with their musical instruments, because I know something about just about
those are just the roadies.
Nicole,
well,
she knows some.
I know, I've got dirt on each of you. Okay, well, we'll start with Paul over here. Paul Cantalone.
Hello.
Is it Cantalone or Cantalon?
Cantalon, as in Cantaloupe.
Ah, okay. Playing the violin, but Paul is actually a concert pianist. You studied at the Paris Conservatory.
Thank you very much.
I do love my public.
And Paul also plays around town. He's got another side project called Triptych.
Yes. It's just for fun. It's quite wonderful for me. Don't speak. Thank you. With Lily Hayden, who's the great rising, extraordinary violinist
she
singer.
Really is, yeah.
And Martin Tillman, the divine rock cellist.
Who has been in here many times.
Yeah.
And you're going to play it sooner.
Playing Wednesday night at the Largo.
There you go.
At 10:30.
And on top of that, Paul is also a gourmet cook.
I don't speak.
He certainly is.
You know, so that's the kind of talent I'm talking about. Scott here on bass plays saxophone and what other instruments? I mean, everything, right?
A little didgeridoo.
Didgeridoo.
A little penny whistle.
Uh-huh.
And a little melodica.
Uh-huh. And I understand you also wrote the theme for Rescue 911.
Oh. See, this is what I'm talking about. You know what?
Yeah, me and old Bill go way back.
Uh-huh. So is it a wig or?
Well, I promised I wouldn't talk about that.
Shark, you know, I don't have a lot of dirt on you. I know you used to play drums.
What do you want?
Yeah,
what
tell us want? Dirt about Shark. He plays an amazing guitar. And he used to be a drummer.
Cadillac Jumbo Margaritas are my favorite drink now.
Okay.
Who is Shark?
I saw him play percussion about a few years ago in London. It was one of the first time I ever met him, and I was in this band, and I went early to see the other band, and there were these four scrubbed, very clean, handsome boys from Canada. They were about 15 or something, and they were in Brixton, heavy duty part of London, you know. And they came out on stage and one at a time. And Shark came out with a couple of sticks in his back pocket. You have to see the way I'm moving here. Uh-huh. You can't see it, but he came out and he just did two timbales, you know, those drums, and he started to do it. Just imagine. And Shark can dance like Elvis. It's just, you know, he can do it. He was born with it.
He is at the moment.
And he jumped about 5 feet in the air. He did like Michael Jordan. He stayed up there with his stick.
Wow. Well, maybe we can get him to do that Thursday night at the Troubadour.
Yeah.
You think?
Well, I think it was more exciting than Angela makes it sound. No.
And he's very modest. Much too modest.
Okay. Back in the other room, and I can't see him right now, which is quite a shame because he's adorable, is Thaddeus Correa. And he plays the mean drums and
he's got a nice deep voice today. Speak with your new voice, Daddy.
You are too kind.
See, look at him. He's like shirtless back there. He's too cute.
No.
And I guess music is in his genes because Dad is Chick Corea.
How do you know what's in my genes?
I've heard. So does Chick ever come out to any of your shows?
You bet. He loves the band.
He's come.
Very cool.
His favorite track's Wake Up Sad.
Dad, I love this new voice. It's amazing.
Hey, you want a part-time job as a disc jockey?
Sure.
Probably use you right now. And Angela, of course, wearing sunglasses today.
Oh, come on. I'm in a bloody room with all these fluorescent lights everywhere.
Late night last night?
We played at the coach house.
Yeah.
For goodness
we rocked.
Sake, I
we
worked.
Rocked.
Well, in addition to this amazing voice, and you write the lyrics, these amazing poems about
life. I'm just amazing.
You are. She draws, too. I think there's a gene somewhere that people who can sing and write songs
can draw.
Look at you, Joni Mitchell. Just look on our board. Well, you did some of
these. Angie from Frenzy. There's a board up here for people listening, and there's lots of little drawings.
Josh Clayton Felt is also quite an artist. But you, your artwork is magnificent.
It's standing out there, isn't it?
So,
a tattoo
there you go. They're all multi-talented. Wild Colonials. The new album is called This Can't Be Life. We missed the show last night at the Coach House, but they are playing Thursday night at the Troubadour. And a very good band, September 67, is opening for you.
Yes, I hear. We're looking forward to seeing that.
Okay, how about another song, guys?
Our special lady.
Shut up, Nicole. You lot. We went to Wolfo House.
Special lady, Nicole.
We'll tell them later.
What are we hearing next?
This Misery.
Who knows?
Barbara,
one,
special lady.
Two,
three. I should say blue eyes.
FM 101.9. You know, I said you're playing this Thursday night at the Troubadour. I've just been informed you're also playing next Thursday night, the 19th, a very special Christmas show at the Troub.
Yes.
And also on the 21st, I think that's a Saturday, at Borders Books on the 3rd Street Promenade in Santa Monica. Do we have a time on that?
5 o'clock.
5 p.m. Oh, a lovely Saturday afternoon.
And you can see Paul on Wednesday. It's
Triptych at Largo at 10:30. It's Paul and Lily Hayden and Martin Tillman. Wonderful music. Piano, violin, and cello. Okay. Mm. What do you think? One
cello.
More? Come on, you guys. You're rocking. You're sounding
good. Shall
groovy.
We keep rocking?
Yeah. Rick, which one's me?
Let's keep rocking.
2, 1.
While Angela's figuring out the headphone situation, I'll also say I left out one of her many talents, which is she's like Miss Social Director.
Excuse me?
You are. Well, everybody loves Angela. Of the scene. Everybody loves Angela. She's one of like the best people and biggest hearted, wonderful people I know.
Oh my God.
And she knows everybody and everybody loves her.
Oh.
You know, hanging around Angela at any time you can find. Can I drop names here?
No.
All right, I won't say like Winona Ryder and Timothy Hutton and people like that. All right, do another song.
Bono.
Really now?
Oh man, I'm gonna kill you guys. Warmer in your bed, so I say.
Wild Colonials in the music hall at FM 101.9.
Special lady.
That was sneaked up on me. That's only the second time I've sang that song acoustically.
Now we're all dead. That was
good for
wonderful.
You.
The Wild Colonials this Thursday and next Thursday at the Troubadour. Also Saturday the 21st at Borders Books on the 3rd Street Promenade in Santa Monica at 5 o'clock. The new album called This Can't Be Life is wonderful. It makes a perfect holiday gift for your loved ones.
You are so right.
You guys are great. I love you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Nicole.
We love you.
So a blast from the past from December of 1996 as I honor my late friend, Angela McCluskey. I thought I'd leave you with one more. A solo recording that she put out some years ago. It was part of one of the Sweet Relief benefit albums that goes to support musicians who have medical problems. It grew out of, Sweet Relief. Look it up. So Angela recorded this rendition of a song that you know for a Sweet Relief benefit album. Thank you for listening. I love you, Angela. Thank you for the music and your friendship. I'll see you all Monday. Here we go.
It's all right.